Okay, in this video I want to talk about finding a potential for a conservative vector field. And recall a vector field capital F. We say that that is what's known as a conservative vector field if there exists a small function, little f, it's a scalar function, so that when we take the gradient of little f, we get capital F back. So by definition, if that happens, we say that capital F is a conservative vector field. The scalar function little f is what's known as a potential, and that's what we're going to find in this video. So recall that the gradient of f, again, is just the partial with respect to x, y, and z. So suppose we've got this vector field here, 2x plus yz, xz, and yx. Assuming a potential exists, let's find it. So we're going to find a function little f, so that when we take the gradient of little f, we get capital F back, okay, our vector field. So again, recalling that the gradient of f is just the partial with respect to x, the partial with respect to y, the partial with respect to z, that's going to have to equal our vector field. So all we do is we just set respective components equal to each other. So it says the partial with respect to x is going to have to equal the 2x plus yz portion. And it says the partial with respect to y would have to equal xz. And then it says that the partial with respect to z is going to equal yx. Okay, so what we start doing now, we've got a little system of equations here. What we're going to start doing is integrating with respect to either x, y, or z. That'll get us back to our original function, little f, and then we'll start taking partial derivatives, and hopefully we can deduce what function we need. So again, we're looking for little f, so that the gradient of f equals capital F. Alright, so this first function, it says if you take the partial with respect to x of our potential function, again assuming it exists, it says you get 2x plus yz. Well, if we integrate that function with respect to x, well, since we took the partial with respect to x, that means we'll integrate with respect to x. If you integrate the 2x, we'll simply get x squared. And then if you integrate the yz portion, we'll simply get xyz. And this is kind of the tricky part, or maybe kind of the new part when you first do these. Previously, when you integrated, remember we would just write plus c. But plus c is not quite correct in this case. I mean, it would be correct, but it's not the most general antiderivative. The idea is, if I take the partial with respect to x of this function, well, I would get the 2x back, I would get the yz back. The constant would certainly go away. But if you think about it, this part over here, it could have been, for example, maybe sine of y. Because again, if I take the partial with respect to x of this function, the sine part's just going to go away anyway. Likewise, it could have been maybe sine of z, for example, because again, that would go away. So the idea is, generically, it could have been any old function of y and z, okay? Because again, if I take the partial derivative of this with respect to x, I will get this partial back. Okay, so what we have at this point, again, it says that little f, then, must be equal to x squared plus xyz plus possibly some function of y and z. Okay, again, recognizing that when we take the derivative of this with respect to x, we will get this back. Okay, so spending a little time on this first step, because I think this is the step that tends to confuse people. I am sure it confused me at first as well. It still does a little bit. It's easy to get all your symbols mixed up, I think, so you got to be careful. Okay, so we know that our potential function f satisfies this. So let me put this up here real quick. So it's got to be x squared plus xyz plus some function, maybe, of y and z. Well, the idea is now what we're going to do is we're going to take the partial of this with respect to y. If we take the partial with respect to y, the x squared portion would just simply go away. If we take the partial with respect to y here, we would simply get xz. And then if we take the partial with respect to y of our function h of yz, well, we would get a partial derivative. We would get the derivative with respect to y of that function yz. Okay, what we do now is we're going to equate, because we know that little f of y had to equal xz, and this tells us that another condition that f of y must satisfy. It says you've got to get xz, which we already had, plus this extra portion. If we set the partials with respect to y equal to each other, we would simply get that this portion, if I can speak correctly, it says that this portion would simply have to equal 0. Okay, again, by equating this partial with respect to y and this partial with respect to y. Okay, so what we know now is then that h of y, yz, we know that that has to equal 0. Okay, well, again, what we're going to do is we're going to backtrack a little bit. Get rid of this part, because I don't think we need that anymore. It says that the partial with respect to y of our h function of yz has to be 0. Well, if we integrate that function with respect to y, because again, we took the partial with respect to y, so we're going to integrate this with respect to y. That's what I'm doing here. It says, well, again, it could have just been a constant, but actually it could have been more than that. It could have been a function of just z. Okay? Again, this could include the constant, because the idea is if I take the partial derivative of a function that was really only involving z, well, the partial derivative of that would go away, and we would get the partial with respect to y simply equaling the xz portion. Okay, so taking a little extra time in this first video, again, I think, you know, finding these potentials can be pretty confusing the first couple times you do them. Okay, so really it says our function that could have been a function of y and z, it's really at most just a function of z. Okay, so now we've deduced a little more information about our potential function. Okay, so let's do the same thing one more time. Okay, so we've got a little more information about our potential function, f. Let's take the partial derivative of that with respect to z. Well, if we take the partial derivative with respect to z, the x squared goes away. The xyz portion would simply leave us with xy if we take the partial derivative with respect to z. And then we would get just g prime of z. Okay, so what we're going to do now, the same thing, if we equate our partial derivatives, well, if we equate these partial derivatives, it tells us simply that we know that we've already got xy and xy on both sides. That's going to tell us simply that g prime of z actually equals 0. And if you integrate this function, again, with respect to z, it was at most a function of z anyway. So we know in this case we'll simply get a constant. And we now, in fact, have figured out our potential function. Okay, because we know that g of z is at most simply a constant. Alright, and notice you can check if you take the partial with respect to x of this function, we will just get 2x plus yz. If we take the partial with respect to y, we'll simply get xz. And if we take the partial with respect to z, we'll simply get yx. So this is in fact a potential function for this original vector field. Alright, I think probably a complicated, maybe first example. Hopefully I spoke correctly. used all the correct terminology. I'm going to do another example of finding a potential for a conservative vector field, and that one I'll step through a little bit faster. So, all right, as always, I hope this helps. Please feel free to post any comments or questions.